Hay un dicho que usamos de que tengo la plata debajo del colchón.
There's an expression that we have that we keep our money under the mattress.
Usualmente es cuando se habla de que no la tengo muy bien invertida.
We say that when we refer to not having invested our money really well.
Hay una historia que encontré buscando joyas, records sobre joyas.
I found an interesting story when I was looking for information records about jewels.
Un pescador en Filipinas hace un poco más de 10 años, como 15 años, él se le atoró su ancla en una ostra gigante.
There was a fisherman in the Philippines about 15 years ago who snagged his anchor in a giant oyster.
En una almeja, más bien era.
Actually, it was a clam.
Y al sacarla, encontró debajo una, dentro de la almeja, una perla que rompió todos los récords.
And when he managed to pry it out of there and get the clam out, there was this record-breaking pearl in it.
Pesa 34 kilos.
It weighs 34 kilos.
Y es 67 centímetros de ancho y 30 y resto de centímetros de alto.
A little over 2 feet long and about a foot tall.
¿Quién quiere ponerse aretes con eso?
Who would like to wear an earring based on this pearl?
Lo curioso es que el pescador este vio qué bonito esta cosa, pero no sabía que era valiosa.
The fisherman, the story goes, he was thrilled with this cool-looking thing that he found in there, but he didn't realize it was very valuable.
Y para él era una buena suerte, y él y sus amigos lo admiraron y lo guardó debajo de la cama.
And for him it was a sign of good luck, so he showed it to his friends, they all got excited, and then he put it under his mattress.
Y 10 años pasaron con este aparato, esta perla debajo de la cama.
10 years went by and this giant pearl was still under the guy's mattress.
Y para peores, se le quemó la casa.
To make matters worse, his house burned down.
Y perlas siendo perlas, nada le pasó a la perla.
And because pearls are pearls, nothing happened to it in the fire.
Pero él ocupaba donde vivir y fue a buscar a su tía.
So he needed another place to live, so he went knocking on his aunt's door.
Y llevó esto y la tía vio esto y dijo, esto es muy único.
And so he carried this souvenir they pulled out of the ocean to his aunt's house, and the aunt said, wow, this is very unique.
Y ella trabajaba en la municipalidad de la ciudad en Filipinas donde él vivía.
And so his aunt worked for the municipality of the city in the Philippines where they lived.
Y lo pusieron en exhibición en la municipalidad.
So they put it on exhibit there in the municipality office.
Y después se le entró la curiosidad de valorar esta perla.
So then they got curious about, maybe we should assess this to find out what it's worth.
100 millones de dólares vale esa perla.
And they found out it was worth $100 million.
Y lo tenía debajo de la cama por 10 años sin saberlo.
And he had it under his mattress for 10 years without knowing.
Las perlas son las únicas joyas que se generan por organismos vivos.
Pearls are the only type of jewels that are generated via live organisms.
Usualmente una contaminación o algún agente externo entra dentro de moluscos que tienen concha.
It usually happens when some impurity, some little contaminant enters into a mollusk that has a shell on the outside.
Y irrita al molusco y ella empieza a cubrirlo con nácar.
So this causes an irritation in the mollusk, so the mollusk secretes this nácar, this substance, to start covering it.
Los expertos presumen o asumen de que esta perla estuvo metida en esta almeja por 100 años para generar esta perla de este tamaño.
Experts estimate that this pearl would have remained inside this clam about 100 years for it to develop to such a size.
Y es curioso porque la Biblia dice en Apocalipsis 21 que las puertas del cielo están hechas de perla.
And it's interesting because Revelation 21 says that the doors of heaven are made of pearls.
Y hay 12 puertas en la ciudad, en la Nueva Jerusalén, y están hechas cada una de una sola perla.
And so there's 12 gates in the holy city in that Revelation describes, and each door is made, or each gate is made of one single pearl.
Me llama la atención Ann Graham Lutz, la hija de Billy Graham.
It strikes me that Ann Graham Lutz, the daughter of Billy Graham.
Ella dice, qué interesante es cuando estemos en el cielo y yo tengo que pasar por esas puertas para ir a adorar al rey.
And she says, it's interesting, I'm picturing when I am in heaven and I get to go through the pearly gates in order to worship the king.
Tengo que pasar por algo que fue hecho por sufrimiento.
I have to go through something that was created through suffering.
Porque la perla es creada por sufrimiento.
Because pearls are created through suffering.
Y les llama la atención, es una joya bonita, pero se tiene una historia de sufrimiento. Y eso nos habla a nosotros del sufrimiento que vivimos en esta tierra. También.
So it's interesting because pearls are beautiful, but they have a story to tell, and they were created through suffering, and that talks to us about the suffering that we go through.
Y por supuesto, el sufrimiento mayor fue el sufrimiento de nuestro Jesús, que él fue el que abrió las puertas del cielo a nosotros.
And of course, the greatest suffering is that of Jesus Christ, who opened the doors to give us life through his suffering.
Hoy vamos a ver unas parábolas que Jesús predicó.
We're going to see some parables today that Jesus preached.
Hace como 3 años aquí en la iglesia vimos una serie que se llamaba Simplemente Profundo, hablando de las parábolas de Jesús.
About 3 years ago, we saw a series here in the church called Simply Profound, which talked about the parables of Jesus.
Las parábolas son pequeñas historias simples, pero que tienen un significado profundo.
Parables are simple stories, but which have a very profound meaning.
Y no voy a explicar todo lo que expliqué hace 3 años en esa serie. Les invito a ir a nuestro canal de YouTube y ahí la pueden disfrutar.
So I'm not going to go back to all the details of what we studied 3 years ago, but I invite you to go to our YouTube channel and search for Simply Profound so that you can learn more about this.
Las parábolas se entienden como uno entiende un chiste.
Parables are to be understood the way we understand a joke.
Un chiste tiene unos componentes que vas contando.
A joke has some components that you start narrating.
Pero esos componentes pueden variar de vez en vez que tú cuentas ese chiste.
But those components can vary a little bit every time the story is retold, the joke is retold.
Entonces, pero tiene un punto chistoso. En inglés se le llama el punchline. Es como el remate del chiste.
But it always has a punchline at the end, right? That's the main focus, the main point of the joke.
Entonces tú cuentas unas historias y después cuentas el remate y eso es lo que hace gracia.
So you tell a little story with a few details and then you arrive to the punchline and that's what makes it funny.
Entonces, no les voy a contar un chiste, pero por ejemplo, en un inicio de chiste yo puedo decir, un sacerdote, un rabino y un pastor se suben a un avión.
So I'm not going to tell you a joke right now, but I can give you by way of example that the story of the joke may start with a priest, a rabbi and a pastor get up into a plane together, board a plane.
Y la siguiente vez que cuento el mismo chiste,
and the following time that I retell that joke,
puedo decir que un cura, un imam y un gurú se suben a un barco.
I may say, well, it was a priest, a guru and an imam who boarded a plane together.
Y el chiste es el mismo con unos componentes un poquito diferentes.
So there's a little variation in the components, but the essence of the joke is the same.
Y por eso es que en algunos vemos en los 4 evangelios hay unas parábolas que varían un poquito aquí o allá.
So we see in the parables, depending on which gospel you read it in, there are slight variations in the details.
Y eso es porque seguramente Jesús contó la parábola muchas veces y ahí varían los detalles, pero no son tan importantes.
And it may be because Jesus told this parable in different contexts and different times, and so that's why we have a few variations in the details, but that's not very important.
Lo importante es el punto de remate de la parábola.
The most important thing really is the punchline of this parable that Jesus would tell.
Entonces vamos a ver, les invito a abrir en Mateo capítulo 13 y vamos a ver 3 parábolas cortitas.
Okay, so I am going to invite you to turn to Matthew chapter 13, and we're going to look at three very short parables.
Yo llamé esta enseñanza el reino inasequible.
I am entitling this teaching the inaccessible or unpurchasable kingdom.
¿Verdad? El reino de los cielos es algo inasequible, es carísimo.
The kingdom of heaven is totally unaffordable. It is as expensive as we can imagine.
Hay uno puede decir, bueno, yo puedo comprar ciertas cosas, pero hay otras que, uy, no debo comprar eso, es inasequible.
So we know through life that there are things that I am able to purchase and others that I just simply can't afford.
¿Verdad? Hay ciertos tipos, hay teléfonos que yo puedo admirar en el mall, pero mejor me compro el que tengo.
Okay, there are certain types of phones that I can admire through the window in the mall there, but I will choose to buy the one that I can really afford.
Y Jesús pone estas tres parábolas hablando de lo inasequible que es el reino de Dios.
And so Jesus mentions these three brief parables in succession to refer to that which is unaffordable or unpurchasable in the kingdom of heaven.
Las parábolas están solo en Mateo y empiezan en el versículo 44 de Mateo 13.
These three parables appear only in the Gospel of Matthew. It starts in verse 44.
Y voy a darles de una vez el bosquejo general con las tres.
I'm going to give you an overview of all three.
La primera es la parábola del tesoro escondido.
The first one is the parable of the hidden treasure.
Y mi bosquejo es, ninguna posesión es mayor que el reino de Dios.
And my outline would say, no possession is greater than or better than the kingdom of God.
Y la segunda es la parábola de la perla de gran precio.
The second parable is the one of the parable of the pearl of great price.
Y ahí la parábola de dos versículos es, ninguna belleza es mayor que el reino de Dios.
And so my outline for this very brief parable of only two verses is that no beauty is greater than the kingdom of God.
Y para terminar, la parábola de la red es, nada mostrará esto como el final de los siglos.
And to conclude, the last parable, which is the parable of the dragnet, would be summarized in this sentence. Nothing will show this like the end.
Ok, vamos a leer Mateo 13:44. Dice Jesús, el reino de los cielos es como un tesoro escondido en un campo.
So we're going to read starting in Matthew 13:44, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field.
Cuando un hombre lo descubrió, lo volvió a esconder y lleno de alegría fue y vendió todo lo que tenía y compró ese campo.
When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy he went and sold all that he had and bought that field.
Ninguna posesión es mayor.
No possession is greater.
Y nos podríamos pasar un buen rato viendo cómo era este hombre, por qué se encontró un tesoro que andaba haciendo.
And we could spend a lot of time, you know, surmising where did this guy come from, how did he trip across this plot of land, what was he doing.
Si era ético lo que estaba haciendo, comprando el terreno para dejarse el tesoro.
Was it ethical that he went and bought the field because he knew there was a treasure in it?
Pero creo que estos son detalles del chiste.
But those are details of the joke, we'll say.
Y el punto es, vendió todo lo que tenía para conseguir ese tesoro.
But the main point or the punchline is he sold everything he had in order to purchase this piece of land.
En la antigüedad la gente sí, no había muchos bancos y los bancos no tenían control gubernamental, entonces la gente a veces enterraba sus tesoros en sus terrenos.
In antiquity, we didn't have a lot of banks and we didn't have government-controlled banks and that type of monitoring system, so people often hid their treasures, buried them somewhere.
Y este hombre nos, ¿verdad? Tal vez estaba arando, qué sé yo, haciendo un picnic, no sé, pero se encontró un tesoro en este terreno.
And this man, we don't know, but we can surmise that he was plowing the land or he was having a picnic and somehow he found this treasure in there.
Y compró el terreno.
And so he purchased the land.
Y obviamente el dueño anterior del terreno no sabía que ese tesoro estaba ahí porque si no lo hubiera sacado.
And obviously, the previous owner of that land had no idea that this treasure was there, or otherwise he would have pulled it out himself.
Pero lo importante es, el reino de Dios vale esta transacción.
The important thing here is that the kingdom of God is worth this transaction.
Aquí tengo una versión artística de este tesoro escondido.
I have an artistic rendition here of this hidden treasure.
Entonces, yo saco algunos puntos de esta parábola.
So I can extract some points from this parable.
El reino es valioso.
The kingdom is valuable.
Eso es lo que Jesús quiere decir. Es, el reino de Dios es valioso.
This is what Jesus is referring to. The kingdom of God is priceless.
Un segundo punto que yo saco de aquí es que el reino es escondido a veces.
A second point that I can derive from here is that the kingdom of heaven is sometimes hidden.
Este hombre, el tesoro no era obvio.
The treasure was not evident to this man.
Hoy en día, el reino de los cielos no es fácilmente visible por cualquiera.
And today, the kingdom of God, likewise, is not easily discernible or seen by just anybody.
Yo vivo en este mundo, pero yo vivo para un Dios que nadie puede ver.
I live in this world, but I live for a God that the average person can't see.
Y tú y yo nos esforzamos, damos nuestro tiempo, nuestro dinero hacia algo que no es fácilmente visible para la gente.
And so no one can see him, and yet you and I, we work and we serve and we do all these things to serve a God that people can't see. The average person doesn't see or doesn't understand.
El reino de Dios a veces es escondido para la gente.
The kingdom of God sometimes is hidden for people.
Una tercera cosa que yo saco de esta breve parábola de nuestro Señor es que el reino de Dios es una fuente de gozo.
The third thing that I can extract from this brief parable is that the kingdom of God is a source of joy.
Porque dice, cuando el hombre lo descubrió, lo volvió a esconder y lleno de alegría, fue y vendió todo lo que tenía.
Because it says that when the guy found it, he hid it again in a hurry, and then he was full of joy, and in that joyful spirit, he went and sold everything he had.
Tal vez su mejor amigo dice, estás chiflado, vendiste todo lo que tenías por este terreno.
And it's possible that his best friend would have said, you're nuts. You're selling absolutely everything you have in order to purchase this plot of land.
Pero Jesús pone ese componente. Está lleno de alegría.
But Jesus adds that component. He is full of joy.
Está lleno de gozo.
He's full of joy.
Tenemos en Dios un acceso a gozo eterno.
In God, we have access to an eternal joy.
En el libro de Nehemías, cuando el pueblo de Israel estaba sufriendo ataque y no podían, estaban reconstruyendo sus muros.
In the book of Jeremiah, when the people of God, the people of Israel, were suffering an attack and they were in the midst of rebuilding their walls.
Nehemías le dice, el gozo del Señor es nuestra fortaleza.
And Nehemiah said, the joy of the Lord is our strength.
El gozo de Dios nos fortalece.
So he's telling the people, the joy of the Lord strengthens us.
Y ese gozo de Dios sigue vivo hoy en día.
And that joy of God continues alive today.
En Gálatas dice que es un fruto del Espíritu. El gozo es un fruto que el Espíritu Santo produce en nosotros.
And Galatians tells us that joy is part of the fruit of the Spirit. It's part of what the Spirit should produce in us, is that joy.
Y Pablo, estando en prisión, dice, regocíjense en el Señor. Otra vez les digo, regocíjense.
And Paul, from prison, writes to his audience and says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice.
Este es un mensaje para nosotros, sabiendo que hay sufrimiento, sabiendo que hay cosas difíciles, accedemos al Dios que nos da gozo.
And this is a message for us. When we're in the midst of hardships, when we're in the midst of tough situations, we have access to the throne of God who brings us that joy.
No estoy diciendo que tenés que falsificar el gozo y andar con una cara de los Simpson aquí fingiendo estar feliz.
I'm not insinuating that we must fake joy when we are not joyful and have this fake smile like in a Simpsons cartoon, making people think that we're joyful when we're not.
Pero sí tenemos acceso al Dios que produce un gozo interno.
But we do have access to this God that produces joy in us.
Los ángeles se aparecieron a los pastores y dijo, yo tengo noticias de gran gozo. Ha nacido en Belén un bebé que es el Salvador del mundo.
The angels told the shepherds, I bring you news of great joy. In Bethlehem has been born a baby who is the Savior of the world.
Tenemos gozo solo por conocer a Jesús.
We have joy just because we know Jesus.
Volvamos a las parábolas, ahora la segunda parábola.
Now let's turn to the second parable.
Ninguna belleza es mayor que el reino.
No beauty is greater than that of the kingdom.
Versículo 45 dice, también se parece el reino de los cielos a un comerciante que andaba buscando perlas finas.
Verse 45 says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant who was looking for fine pearls.
Y cuando encontró una de gran valor, fue y vendió todo lo que tenía y la compró.
And when he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it.
En tiempos actuales, muchas de las perlas que se venden son cultivadas.
In today's world, many of the pearls that we see have been cultivated pearls.
Entonces agarran una almeja o una ostra y le meten un pedacito de plástico.
So they take an oyster or a clam and they put a little tiny piece of plastic or something in it.
Y 3 años después está cubierto de nácar como una perla.
And 3 years later, that little impurity has been surrounded and coated with this hard, brilliant shell that we call nácar in Spanish. I don't know what it's called in English.
Y en tiempos antiguos la perla era muy difícil de conseguir.
And in the olden days, it was very hard to find a pearl.
No tenían la tecnología para ir debajo del agua a buscar.
They didn't have the technology to dive deep underwater and find these pearls.
Lo que hacían era agarrar una gran piedra y abrazaban la pierna y la piedra los hundía y ahí después, una vez bajo el mar, sosteniendo la respiración, buscaban perlas.
The diving technology of those days was to hang on to this huge stone so that you would and hold your breath and you'd be able to sink all the way to the bottom, to the ocean floor, and then go looking around for clams that you could pull up in hopes of finding a pearl.
Las perlas eran más valiosas en aquel momento de lo que lo son ahora.
And pearls were even more valuable back then than what they are today.
En nuestra cultura, el diamante es el producto más caro. La perla en antigüedad era como un diamante.
In today's culture, diamonds are the most valuable thing, but back then a pearl was the most valuable jewel.
Y en esta parábola Jesús nos está compartiendo casi las mismas cosas. El reino es valioso.
And in these two parables, Jesus is referring to the same thing. The kingdom of God is priceless.
Está escondido, hay que buscarlo.
Yeah, but it's hidden, so we must look for it. We must seek it out.
En esta segunda parábola no menciona que es una fuente de gozo.
In this second parable, it doesn't mention that it's a source of joy.
Sin embargo, tiene un componente nuevo que la parábola anterior no tiene.
However, there's a new component here that the previous parable didn't mention.
En la primera, el hombre que encuentra el tesoro, él descubre el tesoro. En la segunda, el comerciante anda buscando una perla.
In the first parable, the farmer or the person on the field just happens upon this treasure. He discovered it accidentally. In the second parable, he's out looking for pearls or valuables.
Y eso nos muestra también cómo el reino de Dios, algunos de nosotros, no lo topamos sin querer, sin andarlo buscando.
And this illustrates how sometimes in our lives, we just trip across something, the kingdom of God. We weren't precisely looking for it.
El ejemplo en la Biblia más claro es el de Pablo.
The perfect example in the Bible is the Apostle Paul.
¿Verdad? Ahí él no andaba buscando el reino de Dios. Jesús se lo topó en la calle y lo botó. Y le dijo, usted va a ser cristiano.
You know, in Paul's case, he wasn't, you know, going about looking for Jesus. He was just walking along the road and Jesus zapped him, knocked him off his horse and said, you're going to serve me. You're going to be a Christian now.
También la mujer samaritana, ella tenía sed y ella fue a buscar agua y se topó a Jesús.
Likewise, with the Samaritan woman, she just went out to get some water at the well, and she happened upon Jesus there.
Sin embargo, Así en esta segunda parábola el comerciante anda buscando una perla.
So, but in this second parable we see that the merchant was actually looking for a pearl.
Algunos de nosotros llegamos a Cristo por equivocación y otros andábamos con sed, andábamos buscando.
Some of us have encountered Jesus, might we say, by accident, while others we were really searching.
En la Biblia pensamos, me hace pensar en el eunuco de Hechos 8.
In the Bible, it makes me think of the eunuch of Acts 8.
El etíope, él andaba buscando. ¿Qué significaba esto en Isaías?
The Ethiopian eunuch was in search of the meaning of that which he was reading.
En Hechos 10 pienso en Cornelio. Él era un hombre piadoso buscando de Dios.
And in Acts 10, it reminds me of Cornelius, who was a godly man. He was pious and he was searching for God in his way.
En Hechos 16, a Lidia que se reunía con él cerca del río y andaba buscando y se topó con Pablo.
And in Acts chapter 16, we think of Lydia, who was by the river, and she was seeking for the Lord, and she encountered Paul.
¿Cuántos aquí rápidamente se toparon sin andar buscando con el reino? Levanten la mano.
How many here kind of ran into Jesus, but we weren't really looking? Raise your hand.
¿Y cuántos aquí estaban buscando algo y buscando y encontraron?
And how many were really searching for God in the best way you knew how, and God met you there?
Algunas personas buscan. Dicen, aquí hay una sed, hay algo más que yo necesito encontrar.
Some people are searching and they say, there's something more to life that I need to find.
Y prueban con la religión, prueban con diferentes experiencias, prueban con filosofías.
And so they start experimenting with different things, religions, philosophies, other things.
Hasta que encuentran la perla de gran precio.
Until they find the pearl of great price.
Nuestro Jesús.
Our Jesus.
Y ahí venden todo lo que tienen para conseguir y adquirir esa perla.
And so they sell everything that they have in order to acquire that precious pearl.
El último punto de estas parábolas es que el reino debe ser adquirido.
The final point of these parables is that the kingdom must be acquired.
Ahora, algunos de ustedes dicen, no, pero el reino es gratis.
But some of you will say, wait a minute, the kingdom is free.
Y sí, la salvación es gratis.
And yes, salvation is free.
Pero hay una pequeña paradoja allí.
But there's a small paradox there.
Hay una paradoja de la salvación.
There's a paradox concerning salvation.
Ahí tengo un triángulo que es una paradoja. Si te quedas viéndolo después de un rato ya te pones mareado.
I have this triangle here that is a sort of optical illusion. So if you stare at it for a while, you start getting dizzy.
La salvación, por un lado, viene solo por la gracia de Dios. Es gratis.
On the one hand, salvation comes by God's grace, and so it is free in that sense.
Pero por otro lado, la salvación le va a costar todo al discípulo.
But on the other hand, salvation, if you are to be a disciple of Christ, will cost you everything.
Y ambos lados de esta paradoja están en la palabra.
And both sides of this paradox are in the word.
La salvación viene solo por la gracia de Dios.
Salvation comes only by God's grace.
En Romanos 3 dice que somos justificados gratuitamente mediante la redención de Jesús.
In Romans 3:24 it says that we are justified freely by the grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus.
En Romanos 6 dice, porque la paga del pecado es muerte, mas la dádiva, el regalo de Dios es vida eterna.
In Romans 6:23 it says that the wages of sin are is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus.
En Efesios 2 dice, porque por gracia ustedes han sido salvados mediante la fe, y esto no procede de ustedes, es regalo de Dios.
And Ephesians 2:8-9 says that it's by grace that we're saved through faith and not something out of ourselves. It is a gift of God, so that no one can boast.
Es un regalo de Dios.
It is a gift of God.
Pero le cuesta todo al discípulo.
But it will cost the disciple everything.
En Mateo 10 dice, el que quiera seguirme a mí, que no esté dispuesto a dejar a madre y a padre, no puede ser mi discípulo.
Matthew says, anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, cannot be my disciple.
Y dice, el que no toma su cruz y me sigue, no es digno de mí.
And it also says that he who does not take his cross up daily is not worthy of following me.
En Lucas 9, un hombre llega y le dice a Jesús, te voy a seguir donde quiera que vayas.
In Luke 9, a guy comes to Jesus and says, I will follow you anywhere you go.
Y primero, al primer hombre le dice, bueno, está bien, pero ojo, el hijo del hombre no tiene ni dónde poner la cabeza.
And so Jesus says to this man, okay, but just be forewarned that the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head.
Y la comodidad, él no estaba dispuesto a rechazar eso.
And so this man was not willing to sacrifice his comfort.
Un segundo hombre le dijo lo mismo y le dice, déjame enterrar a mi padre y después te sigo.
A second man came to him wanting to follow him, but he said, you know what? Let me just go and bury my parents first, and then I'll follow you.
Andaba buscando la herencia primero y después sigue a Jesús.
He wanted to wait for his parents to die, get his inheritance, and then he would follow Jesus.
Y Jesús, no, eso no sirve.
And Jesus said, that won't work.
Y un tercero dice, déjame despedirme de mi familia y después te sigo.
And the third one said, you know what, let me just go and say goodbye to my family and then I'll follow you.
Y Jesús dice, no, sígame ya.
And Jesus said, nope, you follow me now.
Y en Lucas 14, Jesús pone a manera de una ilustración, ningún hombre que construye una torre no cuenta primero cuánto le va a costar antes de construirla.
And by way of illustration, in Luke 14, Jesus uses the illustration of a builder. He says, no man who builds a tower doesn't sit down first and calculate how much it's going to cost him.
Hermanos, para ser discípulo de Jesús, hay un costo.
Brothers and sisters, in order to be a disciple of Jesus, there is a cost involved.
Un costo inasequible.
An unaffordable cost.
Pero nos toca pagar ese precio.
But we must pay that price.
Y eso va a ser diferente para ti que para mí.
And it'll be different. It'll look different to you than for me.
Pero llenos de gozo vale la pena. Eso es lo que estas parábolas está diciendo.
But if this is our source of joy, these parables are saying it will be well worth it.
Y estos dos hombres, el del tesoro y el de la perla, vendieron todo para conseguir el reino de Dios.
And both these men, the one who happened upon the treasure as well as that who the one who was looking for the pearl, they both sold everything they possessed in order to acquire this precious thing.
Y después Jesús va con la tercera parábola que vamos a ver rápidamente.
And then Jesus continues with the third parable that we're going to see quickly.
Primero, ninguna posesión es mejor.
First, no possession is better.
Segundo, ninguna belleza es mayor.
Secondly, no beauty is greater.
Y la tercera palabra, nada mostrará esto como el final.
And the third one is nothing will show this like the end.
Veamos versículo 47.
Let's look at verse 47, Matthew 13.
Dice, también se parece el reino de los cielos a una red echada al lago que recoge peces de toda clase.
Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was thrown down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish.
Cuando se llena, los pescadores la sacan a la orilla, se sientan y recogen en canastos los peces buenos y desechan los malos.
When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up to shore, and then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad ones away.
Y aquí Jesús explica, dice, así será el fin del mundo.
So here comes the punchline. Jesus says, this is how the end of the world will be, the end of the age.
Vendrán los ángeles y apartarán los justos de los justos a los malvados.
The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous.
Y a los malvados los arrojarán al horno encendido donde habrá llanto y rechinar de dientes.
And the evil ones will be thrown into the fiery furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
La red que se habla aquí es una palabra diferente a la red que usaban los pescadores Pedro y Andrés en sus botes.
The net that is talked about here is a different kind of net than the one that the apostles Peter and John used in their fishing boats.
En las otras se tira una red y ahí van sacando peces.
Okay, and the one that the disciples used from their boats, they would just hurl this net and then wait and then pull the fish in.
Pero este tipo de red, que es, esta palabra es distinta, es una red donde se amarra en la playa y después llevan la red al lago.
This is a different type of net. The word is actually a different word, and it describes a net that you would anchor it somehow at the beach, on land, and then you would start dragging it out over the lake.
Y una mitad de la red tiene flotadores y la otra parte tiene pesas. Entonces la red va vertical dentro del lago.
And this type of net has some floaters on one end of it, and it has some weights on the other end. So then, because of the floaters and the weights, the net actually is traveling vertically along the water.
Y ahí se lo van llevando y van haciendo un gran círculo dentro del lago.
And so they start dragging this net over the water, and it starts forming this big circle.
Hasta que la recogen.
Until once they form the big circle, then they start pulling it in a circular form.
Y ahí ya los peces ya no tienen salida.
And so they're all the fish are trapped inside this giant circle that they made. They can't escape.
Recogen de todo.
So, you know, whatever was there, they're reeling it all in, right?
Botellas de Coca-Cola, hay que botarlas.
Coke bottles, you got to chuck those, you know, everything's coming in together.
Y los peces muy pequeños, los peces no comestibles.
Fish that are too small, you got to throw them out or throw them over, and those sort of not edible kind, you throw those out.
Y los peces lo que hacen es, los pescadores hacen es escogen lo bueno.
So the fishermen, after they drag in the net, they have to be doing all the selection process, right? Selecting out the good.
Ahora Jesús está frente al lago de Galilea enseñando esta parábola.
And Jesus is at the edge of the Sea of Galilee teaching this parable.
Y me imagino o ahí había una red o la gente conocía esto, era de su vocabulario, era de su lo cotidiano para ellos.
And so Jesus is referring to everyday life for the people there. They were very familiar with this. There might have even been a dragnet just lying around as an illustration when he was saying this.
Y aquí Jesús la explica en el 49, así será el fin del mundo.
And so now Jesus explains what he means with the parable in verse 49. He says, this is how it will be at the end of the age.
Vendrán los ángeles y apartarán de los justos a los malvados.
The angels will come and will separate the wicked from the righteous.
La semana pasada estuvimos hablando del fin del mundo también.
Last week we were talking about the end of the age as well.
Y estábamos transmitiendo un mensaje de que no se alarmen.
We were transmitting a message saying, do not be alarmed.
Mantengan la calma y sigan adelante.
Keep calm and carry on.
Esto viene en contraposición, un poco en tensión con esto.
Today's teaching is a little bit in contrast with what we saw last week.
Porque sí, mantengan la calma, pero va a llegar un momento final.
Because yes, we need to remain calm, but we also need to know that a final day will come.
Y ese momento final, aquellos que están en el reino, están en el reino, los que están fuera, ya no hay opción.
And that will be a day of judgment and separation, so that those who are in the kingdom will remain in the kingdom, and those who have not been, they lost their last chance.
Y entonces, aquellos que vendieron todo para entrar al reino, como en las parábolas anteriores, van a estar salvos.
And so those who sold or gave up everything they had in order to be in Christ, to be in the kingdom, will be saved.
Pero aquellos que no vendieron todo, no consiguieron, no adquirieron el reino, van a ser desechados.
But those who were not willing to give up what they had in this world in order to search after the kingdom, did not acquire the kingdom, they will be discarded.
Me encontré un artista que hizo un dibujo en una sola imagen toda esta parábola.
I found an artist that illustrated in one picture this whole parable.
Ahí se ven los ángeles cosechando.
You can see the angels harvesting there.
Y están escogiendo peces.
And they are selecting the fish.
Y veo en el horno escondido hay mantarrayas y tiburones.
¿Y en el qué escondido?
En el horno.
Oh, okay. And there's a hidden oven there, or furnace actually, a furnace, and there's like snakes and stingrays and stuff in it.
Es una ilustración de cómo en el fin es esa división se va a dar.
And it's an illustration of how at the end of the age that division or that separation is going to take place.
Unos minutos antes de que esa red entre, Los peces no saben que ya casi viene el final.
Just a few minutes before that dragnet circles around and pulls them in, the fish don't know that their end is about to happen.
También el final, los que están, los peces buenos y los peces malos, todos son cosechados en el mismo tiempo en esta parábola.
And in this parable, we see that both the good fish and the bad fish are all harvested together at the same time.
Y unos minutos antes, imagínese el pececillo que anda por ahí y se topa con la red.
And just imagine a few minutes before, the little fish is just swimming happily along, and all of a sudden he sees this net coming around him.
Y no puede pasar por la red.
And he can't get through the net.
Mantenga calma y sigue adelante y va por al otro lado.
So the fish doesn't worry, just changes direction. I'll just swim in this other direction.
Y hermanos, cada vez que sucede algo en el mundo que nos son señales del fin, es como esa red que está dando la vuelta, dando la vuelta.
And brothers and sisters, every time we come across something that is a sign that we're approaching the end of the age, it's like that dragnet that is circling around and circling around.
De repente hay problemas económicos, de repente hay tsunamis o hay guerras y rumores de guerras.
All of a sudden we have these natural disasters like tsunamis, and there's wars and rumors of wars, and there's these big financial trouble.
Esa es la red que está dándole la vuelta a todos los que estamos en el lago.
That is the type, a type of dragnet of sorts that is slowly circling around all of us.
Y el reino de Dios está avanzando silenciosa e invencible.
And the kingdom of God is advancing silently and invincible.
Y entonces, aunque es cierto que mantengan la calma y sigan adelante, también es una urgencia porque hay personas que se van a perder.
And just as we are supposed to remain calm and carry on, there is also this sense of urgency because there are people that are unaware of what's happening and they will be lost if we don't do something about it.
Y Jesús ahí, aquí menciona el horno encendido donde habrá llanto y rechinar de dientes.
And Jesus here is making mention of a fiery furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
Y nadie habló más acerca del infierno que nuestro Señor Jesús.
And no one in the Bible spoke more about hell than our Lord Jesus Christ.
En este mismo capítulo lo menciona tres veces.
Just in this chapter he mentions it three times.
En otras parábolas él dice que va a separar las ovejas de las cabras.
In other parables he talks about separating the goats from the sheep.
Y dice las ovejas entrarán en el reino de su padre y las cabras al fuego eterno.
And he says, and the sheep will go into the kingdom of their father, and the goats will be thrown out into the eternal fire.
En la parábola de la cizaña y el trigo también, and la cizaña es tirada al fuego.
And then in the other parable of the wheat and the tares, he mentions the exact same thing, and he says the tares will be separated and thrown into the fire.
Entonces tenemos una urgencia por alcanzar aquellos que sospechamos que van a ser desechados al fin.
So we have a sense of urgency to reach out to those that we suspect may be thrown into the fiery furnace.
Y nos toca a nosotros llevar el reino de Dios a aquellos los que están buscando y los que no están buscando.
And it's our responsibility to be bearers of the kingdom of God, both to those who are searching as well as to those who aren't.
Termino con los versículos 51 y 52.
And I want to conclude with verses 51 and 52.
Jesús, al final de contar estas parábolas, le dice a sus discípulos, ¿han entendido todo esto?
At the end of telling these three parables, Jesus says to them, have you understood all these things?
Sí, le respondieron ellos.
Yes, they replied.
Entonces Jesús dijo,
then Jesus said to them,
todo maestro de la ley que ha sido instruido acerca del reino de los cielos es como un dueño de una casa que de lo que tiene guardado saca tesoros nuevos y viejos.
So he says to them, therefore, every teacher of the law who has been instructed about the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old.
Ya aquí Jesús no está predicándole a una multitud, está hablándole a sus doce.
And at this point, Jesus is no longer preaching to the multitude. He is just conversing with his 12 disciples.
Y les llama maestros de la ley.
And he calls them teachers of the law.
Y nos llama a todos nosotros también maestros de la ley.
And by association, he's calling all of us as well, teachers of the law.
Algunos de nosotros trabajamos predicando.
Some of us, our job is to preach.
Pero muchos, todos nosotros predicamos con nuestras vidas.
But all of us are to be preaching with our lives.
Ahí con el que está a la par tuya, dígale, sos maestro de la ley.
Just nudge the person next to you and say, you're a teacher of the law.
Todo maestro de la ley que ha sido instruido en el reino de los cielos.
Every teacher of the law who has been instructed in the kingdom of heaven.
Es como alguien que tiene dos tipos de cosas en su casa.
It's like someone who has two types of things in his house.
Tesoros nuevos y tesoros viejos.
New treasures and old treasures.
Y todos tenemos que traer de ambos tesoros a llevar.
And both of us need to draw out from both types of treasures to bring it to the people.
Y eso se puede hablar en muchos aspectos.
And we can talk about this in many ways or many aspects.
Para los discípulos aquí, ellos tenían toda la ley de Moisés y lo que conocemos como el Antiguo Testamento.
For the disciples here that Jesus was talking to, they had what we call the Old Testament. They had the law and the prophets to draw
Esos
from.
Esos eran los tesoros viejos.
Those were the old treasures.
Y aquí viene Jesús y les está explicando la ley, les está ampliando y son tesoros nuevos.
And so Jesus comes and he explains the law to them, but he reveals the new things about the law to them as well, and those are the new treasures.
Y todos nosotros tenemos tesoros antiguos y tesoros nuevos.
And all of us have old treasures as well as new treasures.
Y algunas cosas son mi experiencia con Dios de ayer en la mañana.
And some of these things we might share are my experiences with God of yesterday morning.
Y otras son mi conocer de Dios de años y mi entendimiento de los 10 mandamientos.
And other things may be my understanding of the things of the Lord, the 10 commandments, other truths of the word that I have known for years.
Ambos son tesoros.
Both are treasures.
Ambos son importantes para ser maestro de la ley, para enseñar a otros.
Both are equally important to be good teachers of the law and to instruct others.
Siempre estamos actualizados.
We are always updated.
Pero nunca despreciando el pasado.
But we're always updating ourselves, but we never neglect or underestimate the past, the treasures of the past.
Tenga tesoros viejos y tesoros nuevos para llevar a los demás.
Draw upon the old treasures as well as the new treasures to bring them forth to the other, to the people that need to hear.
El reino de los cielos es más valioso que cualquier otra cosa que podamos tener.
The kingdom of heaven is much more valuable than any other thing that we might possess.
Y una persona debe estar dispuesta a renunciar a todo para obtenerlo.
And we must be willing to set aside everything in order to acquire the kingdom of heaven.
Y el precio de no adquirir el reino es extremadamente alto.
And the price or the cost of not acquiring the kingdom is extremely high.
Un rechinar de dientes.
It's a weeping and gnashing of teeth.
Uh-huh. Señor Jesús, gracias porque tu palabra nos enseña cómo debemos de vivir.
Lord Jesus, we thank you because your word teaches us how we must live.
Y queremos llevar este reino de los cielos a otros.
And we must carry this kingdom of heaven to others.
Queremos ser embajadores de tu reino.
We want to be ambassadors of your kingdom, Lord.
Queremos llevarlo a personas que están buscando y a los que no lo están buscando.
We want to carry this kingdom of heaven equally to those who are searching as well as to those who aren't, Lord.
Queremos estar dispuestos, Señor, a renunciar a lo que sea porque conseguimos estar contigo.
And Lord, we are willing to surrender everything in order to be with those, with you and with those who need you.
Y conforme hay señales del fin, es como esta red que se está cerrando.
And just as the signs of the end of the age illustrate a dragnet that is encircling us.
Señor, queremos tomar esa urgencia y llevar tu evangelio a aquellos que están necesitados.
Lord, we want to take on this sense of urgency and take your gospel to those who are needy of it.
Yo te pido, Señor, que cada uno de nosotros aquí, los que están en sus casas, los que están viendo esta grabación,
Lord, and I ask that everyone present here and those who are at home watching this transmission,
Señor, que tú nos des una tarea por hacer hoy o mañana.
Lord, we ask that you would put across our path a task to do today and tomorrow even.
Señor, alguien a quien llamar, alguien a quien buscar, alguien a quien bendecir.
Lord, put it on our minds someone whom we must search out, someone we can call, someone we can bless.
Para llevar tu evangelio, tu reino ahí.
To carry your gospel and your kingdom to them.
Gracias, Señor, por tu palabra.
Thank you, Lord, for your word.
Queremos ponerla por hecho, Señor.
We want to be doers of your word, Lord.
Gracias, Señor Jesús, te damos.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amén.
Amen.
Amén.